Hello and happy Sabbath, church. Happy Sabbath. Thank you all for being here today, especially in person on Zoom. May you all be blessed as we do a special Sabbath today. We'll be doing the Lord's Supper. I know we haven't been doing the foot washing for a while. So for 2 years, we haven't been doing it. For today, we will be doing it, right? So please keep your minds and your heart open to receive the Lord's blessing. And may we all be cleansed of our sins for the grace of the Lord. Now, I just want to praise and honor the Lord and thank everyone who's here. I know we have some visitors. I don't have extra mics here, but visitors, if you can you please stand up right now? All right. Amen. Amen. Thank you for welcoming. And I think Elder Ed has the mic, so just can you let us know where you're coming from? Your name and where you're coming from.
My name is Minerva Mustralis. I'm Yuli and Diane's. I'm Yuli's mom.
Hello.
And my husband, Ulysses Mustralis. We're from Fremont, Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Amen. Thank you for coming again, Tito and Tita.
Thank you.
Hello. Hello, everybody. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
This is all our family. We are from Loma Linda. We are Jiren and Rosa's cousins.
Ah, welcome.
Yes. So hello,
thank
everybody.
Hello.
Hi, happy Sabbath,
hello,
everyone.
Happy Sabbath.
I'm Giselle Lagarilla from Oceanside, California.
Oh, welcome.
I'm visiting.
All right, we got a lot of Cali people today. Thank you, everyone, for being here. And also online, thank you all for joining us if you're a visitor. Thank you for attending, and hopefully you all will be blessed for today. So before I go, I will read Psalms 96, 8 to 9. That's Psalms 96, verse 8 to 9. Give unto the Lord the glory due unto his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Or worship the Lord in the beauty of his holiness. Fear before him all the earth. May we bow our head for prayer. Lord, Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your wonderfulness that you have given to us throughout this day and throughout this week, dear Lord. Thank you for the blessings and for leading us, dear God. You know how hard sometimes our lives can get and how we as simple people, simple beings, dear Lord, we forget to acknowledge what you have done to us, dear Lord. So as today, as this Sabbath day is upon us, dear Lord, may we put all our trials and our problems and our worries away and give it to you, dear Lord, and may you take care of it. But may we focus our hearts and mind upon you and you alone, for you are our sustainer, our redeemer, and our friend. Thank you so much for everything you had done. Please be with us and send thy Holy Spirit to be upon us today to hear your message and to participate with one another to glorify and honor you. In Jesus, I pray in loving name. Amen. Amen. Now I'm going to give the time to our music team.
They never said, here is how you behave. So here's a model of good behavior. So a lot of times parents can cripple their children.
Good morning, everybody. If you love the Lord, say amen.
Amen.
If God's been good to you, say praise the Lord. We're going to sing for our first song today, hymn number 422. We're marching to Zion. Thank you.
hills of Zion, hills of thousands say.
By observation, you know I'm a choir director. I heard more voices over here than I heard over here. So let's see if we can balance that off or we can get these folks over here to make a joyful noise and help us with this next song. I might have to come over here with a mic. Hymn number 462, Blessed Assurance. Sounding good right now. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, but a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story. Perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my side.
Angels descending, bring from above
echoes of mercy, whispers of love. Oh, this is my story. Savior, am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. Oh, this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. Savior all the day long. We got some singers over here, but when I got close to them, they got nervous. Let us stand for our morning hymn. Hymn number 249, Praise Him. Blessed Redeemer.
Our scripture reading this morning is found in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 10. Again, that is Isaiah 53, verse 10. It says, "Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hands." Let us bow our head for a prayer. Father God, we come with praises and in honor of your Sabbath morning, with thankfulness for this privilege of being together in worship with you and with our brothers and sisters. Though some of us are in physical distance from one another, we adore you for making it possible for us to come together in your name. Father, as we honor you today, may our hearts be filled with your love to exude your character, not only in our words, but in our actions. We ask for your presence to be in our midst with the leading of the Holy Spirit, especially our worship participants, both in Sabbath school and in divine worship. May you fill them with your spirit as they serve you, Lord. May you bless each and every one of us here, physically and virtually present here, and please extend your traveling mercies for those who are on their way here at church. I thank you, Father, for all the blessings you poured on us throughout the week. Please guide us in all our ways and step to keep this Sabbath day holy. We praise you and love you, for you are the greatest in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, church. So we are in our portion for our program for tithes and offering. Our tithes and offering this morning is entitled, "Who Can Outgive God?" It says in 1 Chronicles 29:14, "But who am I and who are my people that we should be able to give as generously as this? Everything comes from you, and we have given you only what comes from your hand." Our generosity is inspired by God's generosity. In preparation for the construction of the temple, the Bible reports in the generosity of Israel.
First, King David gave lavishly out of his personal treasures. Then the other leaders gave willingly, following his example. Inspired by their leaders, the rest of the people gave freely and wholeheartedly to the Lord, seeing such an expression of generosity. David burst into praise and mentioned the factor giving, such as a profession of giving. Everything comes from you, and we have given you only what comes from your hand. David gave us the response to what God had already provided: forgiveness, presence, promises, and abundance. No one can outgive God, even if someone chooses to give everything. God has all the means to replenish that person's resources. This was the mindset of David, a leader giver in Israel. In Abraham, the Mazaman had a similar mindset as well. He was the owner of 1,000 head of cattle and large herds of sheep and goats, acknowledging that God was the source of blessings. He decided to be faithful to God. He placed his cattle in large pens and counted them as they walked through a chute. Abraham dedicated each tenth cow as tithe for God. His friends and acquaintances were amazed. In their culture, people's wealth is measured in cattle. One doesn't just give away their cows. They began to mock him, and many people declared him to be crazy. But the laughter abruptly stopped 9 months later when 40 of Abraham's cows gave birth to twins. In addition, many of his goats and sheep birthed triplets. Does he speak then, not act? Does he promise and not fulfill? That says in Numbers 23:19. This week, as we worship with our tithes and offerings, called promise, let us reflect on the truthfulness of these words in our life. And we have three ways where to send your tithes and offerings. We have the online giving. You may go to AdventistGiving.org. You may scroll down and you choose Las Vegas Phil-Am SDA Church or Living Water Fellowship. And we have as well our P.O. Box. You can write your check to pay to Las Vegas Phil-Am SDA Church or Living Water. And we have as well our in-person tithes and offering. You guys can get our envelope and the exit door, and you can put your tithes and offerings. And I want to thank you everyone for your continued support for Las Vegas Phil-Am SDA Church, for sending your tithes and offering every Sabbath, as well as with the Living Water. Let's pray with our offering. Lord, your generosity toward us has no limit. And help us, O Lord, that we are so generous as well to share our blessings to others. And we thank you, Lord, for the many blessings that we receive. And we return our tithes and offering today as a symbol of our love and a symbol of the blessings that we receive from you. Blessed, O Lord, and this is I pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Happy Sabbath, boys and girls. Happy Sabbath, bigger boys and girls. So who wants to see an experiment where we attempt to make a rainbow? All right, let's get started. So we have four cups here, and we're going to fill each cup with water, hot water. It's hot water. Next, we're gonna add some sugar to our water. So we're not gonna add any sugar to one cup. And then the second cup, we're going to add 1 tablespoon of sugar. The third cup, we'll add 2 tablespoons of sugar. And the fourth cup, we'll add 3 tablespoons. And we give that a nice stir. Let it dissolve. Now we're going to add some color into our water. And we have yellow, red, green, and blue. So we're just going to add a few drops to each. Give it a little stir, let it stir, and let it stir. Now I'm going to take my handy straw and attempt to have the liquid separate. Let's do it again. Oh, it keeps dripping out. So if you look closely, you'll see the colors separating, and it kind of forms a rainbow. So why did this happen? It's because of a simple thing called density. And density is the measurement of how much space is occupied in an object or substance. In this case, the substance is the water. Now, the first container had no sugar, and then we gradually added sugar and increased the sugar. And if you notice at the end, we got a nice, beautiful rainbow. So we're all, you know, we begin like this first cup. You know, we have no sugar at all in us. But through praying, learning more about Jesus, each day we get more sugar. And as I would like to call it, the divine sugar, which is Jesus. So as we increase in knowledge and understanding of God, each and every day, our lives are transformed into this beautiful thing, just like the rainbow that was created here. And so it's good for us to, you know, daily pray, read our Bibles, and just give God thanks so that our lives can be transformed into a beautiful rainbow, so that when people see us, they can see God's glory in our lives. Can I have a volunteer to pray? Anyone? Sophia?
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful Sabbath day that you've given us, and thank you for all the blessings that you've blessed us with, and bless all the sick in mentally, physically, and emotionally, and heal them. And thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. That was so on the spot.
Thank you.
Remain here.
All right, stay here, guys. Are there more kids in the audience? So we're going to do something more special right now because... So are you guys ready for school? School starts on Monday. So that's on the 15th. You're lucky. No? So raise your hand if you are excited about going back to school. Can't wait. Come on. Okay, we have some here. All right. Oh, all the parents are excited, huh? All right. How many of you are going to a new school? New school. Oh, brother. Big handshake. You're going to the grade. What grade are you going to?
I'm going to ninth grade.
Ninth grade, freshman. All right. A lot of big things. Going to high school. So, anyone's going to any new school? Just you? All right. So, for all of you, I know the thought of having a new teacher and new friends, new school can be scary. So hopefully it's none of you here. But actually, my daughter, she's 4 years old. She's going to school for the first time. Chanel is going to preschool for the first time. So, but she's excited. She can't wait. And the other two are going to a new school now. So I know it's nerve-wracking and how it used to be. But at this time, we're going to do a special prayer for all the parents and all the kids. So any of the parents, if you could please come forward as well and bring your kids as Elder Gary is going to do a special prayer. So we're going to ask God for his divine intervention during the school year. Because I know even some parents sometimes we also are scared and maybe afraid to send our kids to school. But we want God to bless them and protect them and shield them under his wings.
Okay, I'm going to ask JL and Ed, I want you to come behind the kids and kind of just hold your hands over them. Okay? Parents, if you would like to come up and put your hands over your kids, And remember, this is a church of free will, Bill. God doesn't force anything, and neither do we. Come on, stand behind him.
Yeah.
Or, yeah, you can sit beside them or stand behind them. You're going to school. May not be here, but you're still going to school. So we want to ask God's blessing upon you. All right. Let us pray. Father God, we are holding our hands over the children of the church. Parents are holding their hands over their children or maybe even on them. We're asking for your divine blessing to be upon them, Lord, as they get ready to go back to school, that you would give them wisdom, that you would give them patience, that you would give them a spirit of love when they meet with their fellow students. Some of them may not be very loving, but we want our kids to show them Christ's love, because that's what will draw them to you. And so we pray, Father, that you would keep them safe. Especially pray for that in this world right now. And we just pray, Father, for the Holy Spirit to continue to abide with them day by day, but also that they too, when they start their day, will remember to ask the Holy Spirit to be with them, to lead and to guide them through their day. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
So for the kids who's 10 and above, please remain here in the sanctuary. For the kids, so all juniors, you'll remain here so you can participate. For the kids and below, the little tiny kids, you can go with the Ivy in the back to have children's church. Thank you.
So Brother Dennis Cooper will lead us into our hymn selection. We gather together, hymn number 8. Third verse. Oh,
welcome you to our communion service. As we open up today, I just want everyone to understand, to make sure that we are all on the same page. We practice communion service in recognition of what God has done for us. He has left us this example of having communion, which is really a tie over from the Passover. And so on that very night, Jesus, he gave his disciples and all his followers a commandment to actually have the communion service. But before the communion service are the ordinance of humility. There is a service that we call the ordinance of humility, which is actually the washing of one another's feet. Amen? Amen. How many of us like to wash one another's feet? Let me see your hands. Some are saying, right. Now back then, when the disciples came together, and what Jesus was doing was something that was like really out of this world. This was something that was, I would say, almost shameful to do, right? But usually when you go to someone's house, they would be traveling for miles and miles, and they would be walking around with their dusty sandals, and they didn't have paved roads like what we have. They didn't really have everything all clean and put together as in Las Vegas and some of our metropolises right across the world. And so when they got to someone's house, someone's feet may be full of mud. And so it was customary that at the entrance of that someone's house, they will have a pitcher and with some water and towels to wash each other's feet. And usually, if it is someone of some standing, you'd have servants right by the entrance of the house. And so as soon as the visitor showed up, they would basically lift up their skirt tails, because everyone at that time wore these long robes, men and women. And usually what would happen, they would have to lift up and they will make sure their feet are washed, right? Feet washed, dried, and then they will enter the house. Now Jesus, as a transformational leader as he is, he decided that he was going to do something different. He wanted to show his disciples true humility. And so Jesus, he became the servant. He asked them to wait in that upper room, and Jesus took a towel and girded around him, and he knelt down and he became the servant, washing one another's, his disciples' feet. Many of you know the example that was when he came to Peter, and Peter says, no, Lord, you shall not wash my feet at all. And Jesus says, if I do not wash your feet, you have no part in me. And when Peter understood what Jesus was saying, he says, not just my feet, Lord, but my whole body. In a sense, he wanted to be baptized. He wanted to be recognized fully in Jesus Christ. And so in Mark chapter 7, verse 8, it says, laying aside the commandments of God, you hold the tradition of men, the washing of the pitcher and cups, and many others do such things. And so what happens, there are certain traditions that's established by man, but we see a tradition now that Jesus is actually establishing for each and every one of his followers. He wants each and every one of us to humble ourselves. It is not a president, it is not a pastor, it is not an elder, it is not a deacon, it is not a deaconess. that is higher than each other. At the foot of the cross, the ground is level, and each and every one of us, we are standing around the cross and looking to Jesus. And so Jesus became our example, and he asked each and every one of us to humble ourselves and serve each other by the symbol of the ordinance of humility, washing one another's feet. And so as we prepare to do this in honor of what Jesus Christ left for us, we want to take this opportunity to wash one another's feet. You don't have to be a member. You don't have to be a baptized member. All that you have to do is to accept this ordinance of humility and participate in it. And this will help us to be more like Jesus and adhere to his commands. And so at this time, we are going to be taking a break, and we're going to be asking each and every one of you, men with men, women with women, or if you are a couple, you can wash one another's feet if you haven't done so already this morning or this week. But the idea is that we want to reserve, if families want to wash each other's feet, that's fine as well. But we want to take this as a time of prayer. Before you wash someone's feet, exchange a prayer request. You may be praying for something, praying for a family member or what have you. Take this time for you to bond together, pray together while you wash one another's feet. After the washing of the feet, we're going to ask you to wash your hands and so forth and come back in here. And we are going to have at this time for those of you that finish and come in here, you could have an opportunity to give some testimonies, and we're going to have some songs until we all have each other's feet washed, and then we will resume with our program. Amen. And so at this time, we're going to invite everyone to bow your heads as we pray for this process. Then afterwards, we're going to invite you to go to the back and start the washing of each other's feet. Let us pray. Father God, we want to give you thanks for your grace. We thank you for your love. We in this church and those listening online, we come, Lord, asking for you to bless us. We know that this is not something that we do for show. We do this because this is your command. You're asking, Lord, for each and every one of us to come and to humble ourselves and to recognize that we are all on the same level. We pray, Father, that you will bless us even now as we come to wash one another's feet, Father. Help us to know that this is the atmosphere and the mindset and the character of heaven. I pray that you will bless us now. Bless those that's listening online that will be participating and doing the same, and those within the church. We thank you, Lord. We praise you. We worship and adore you, for we ask these things in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Let us separate.
There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing.
Can I wash your feet?
Worth,
oh, yeah. Yeah, let's do it. You could
it
stay right here.
It sounds like music in my ear. The sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of His precious blood.
we've had the opportunity of washing one another's feet. It's one of the things that the Nevada-Utah conference that we look at is we want it to be a caring conference. And so I wore this shirt. They gave us this shirt about a year and a half ago. And I tried to wear it to different occasions. And I thought that what better occasion to wear it than a communion Sabbath? One of the things that we are going to be talking about later in our message is the idea of caring for each other. Many times, many of us that have grown up in any church, we tend to have this view of communion. It's just a service, a ritual service, ritualistic service that we do every 3 months. But we don't necessarily understand the meaning of communion. And so the meaning of communion, let me just ask her, does anyone know what that word communion means? This is a communion Sabbath school lesson. Okay, together. Okay, I see Brother Rob he's doing this. Yes. All right, I like that. You can't debate that. That's definitely so. Can somebody put that in words? What is it? Communion. What is coming together? Yes. In one accord. I love that. One accord. Yes. What else? What's that, brother? What is communion? Communion. Yes, I love that. Relationship. All of those answers are key on. Yes. Yes, communion and community, they come from the same root. There's another word that is found in that root as well. Yes, fellowship. Fellowship. In fact, communion actually means exactly what that is, what it is. Fellowship. You know, and I know that sometimes we grow up in different traditions, and some of our traditions just somehow we just do the rituals, but we don't understand that it's really all about people. It's all about relationship. It's all about community. It's all about coming together, recognizing the need for each other. Now, in the book of Acts chapter 2, and this is not in my message, but Acts chapter 2, if you notice the last few verses of Acts chapter 2, it says that they had daily communion. They had daily communion because every single day, the new church, they met together, they ate together. Amen? They studied together. They prayed together. They had that fellowship together. And what happened out of that fellowship, out of that communion that they had, it just grew and it magnified in an amazing way. That what happened is that they started looking out for the needs of each other. So at that time, every single person that was found in this new apostolic church, guess what? Nobody was homeless. Do you know what that means? They were able to cancel homelessness among the Christians. And, you know, one of the things that when I came to Vegas, I attended a few workshops with the mayor. And the mayor has this audacious goal to end homelessness in Las Vegas. They ended homelessness back then in the Apostolic Church. Nobody went hungry. Nobody went without a house, right? Because everyone, the rich and the poor, everyone, they sold all their belongings and they put it together in one pool. And I know somebody's going to, you know, some politically minded person is going to say, isn't that socialism? Yeah, it was. It was some form of socialism, yes. But they wanted to make sure that everyone in the church was taken care of. I believe there will be a time in the last days when the Holy Spirit will be poured out upon all the church, every single person. And we're going to look around and we're not going to see that, hey, this is my house, this is my car, right? We're not going to have any territorial divide. There's not going to be any territorial divide between, hey, this is the Philam Church, this is the Living Water Church, or this is the African American Church, this is where the black people go, this is where the Filipino go, this is where the Spanish go. Guess what? It's going to be all together. Every single one coming together, praising God every Sabbath. And guess what? That is what we're working towards in New Jerusalem. New Jerusalem is going to be all about the population of all of us coming together, serving God, recognize that we have one God. And guess what? We have one race. And you know what that race is? Huh? The human race. Come on, everybody. That's what it's all about, right? And so many of us, we drink the Kool-Aid, and we have been fighting this political divide. And yeah, we're Asian. We're Asian American. We're African American. We're white Americans. I'm Jamaican. The fact of the matter, we're all going to come together and we're going to be one in Christ. Amen? Amen? We have participated in the ordinance of humility. And this is one of the purposes of the ordinance of humility. For every single one of us coming together, recognizing that we're one. I grew up in this church, and from a little boy, I remember they used to say, oh, you can't take communion, you're too young. And I said, I want to wash my feet. I want to eat the bread. I want to drink the wine. And some of the elders said, nope, you can't do it, you know, because you're going to take it for granted. Guess what? We do not deny anyone communion in this church. Amen? Whether you are a little boy or a little girl, whether you're an old man, whether you are a member or not, we all come together and celebrate, because this is what heaven is all about. This is what it's all about. Acceptance of every single person. Whether you have no hair or a lot of hair, amen? Whether you have one tooth in your mouth or a full row of corn grains, right? It doesn't matter, right? We are coming together to praise God, and we praise Him anyhow. Amen? Amen. And so we want to thank God for this experience. And so we look forward to the next time when we shall wash one another's feet. Amen? Amen. How many of you guys enjoyed washing one another's feet? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Some of you guys are super honest. You said, no. Let us pray. Father God, we just want to give you thanks. We praise you, Lord. You're a wonderful God. You have called us, Lord, once again into this fellowship, as in the apostolic church back then. And I pray, Father, that we will just break down all of these divisions that has been erected politically by man and by Satan to keep us apart. I pray, Father, that we will come together recognizing that we are one in you. Kindly bless us, Lord. Lead us now as we even prepare for the formal communion service, the emblems of the bread, broken body, and the spilt blood of Jesus Christ. Kindly bless us now. Lead us now, we pray. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Amen. So at this time, we are going to prepare ourselves to enter into the communion service. And we're going to ask all the deacons and deaconesses to ready yourselves, and the elders, as we get into this. We're going to be having a special message in song by Sister June. Is your brother? Brother June. Thank you very much, Brother June.
Blessed for the song titled Jesus Still.
for the answer.
Brother June, praise the Lord. Jesus truly is still the answer. Father God, we ask that you bless us, lead us as we open your words today. We know, Father, you have called us for this time, and we just ask that you please lead and prepare our hearts for your words. Hide me behind Calvary's cross, Lord, as we share this brief word to your people. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The scripture tells us in the book of Galatians chapter 4, verse 4, it says, but when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under the law. Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. This text is very powerful. It is very clear that God, our sermon title, sent in the fullness of time. God sent. When man sinned in the garden, we see that man, he rebelled and she rebelled against God, and consequently, God had to send them out of the garden. Genesis chapter 3, verse 23. It says, therefore, the Lord God sent forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. God sent them out of the garden. I want to put forth the thesis to you this morning that when God sends, something is about to happen. That when God actually moves and decides to send, there's an active a form of some kind of movement that is happening, and God is preparing for something great. Adam and Eve, they were born in a perfect world. They did not understand fundamentally fully what death was. They didn't understand what sin was, but God had given them a specific command to obey me and do not touch of the forbidden tree or eat of the forbidden tree. But when man reached out with his wife, Adam and Eve, and took off the fruit of this forbidden fruit, it says that God had to do something. He had to send them out of the garden. And the garden was guarded by a cherubim, an angel with a flaming sword, and they could not enter back into that garden. And one of the reasons that they could not enter in, because if they had gone back into the garden and eaten of the tree of life, man will become immortal sinners. Very interesting. Break that down. And some of you, I know some of you is going to come in Bible class this evening at 5 and ask, tell us about that. Let's study a little on that. Can you imagine a sinner that cannot die? Can you imagine the trouble that God will have in this world if he had an immortal sinner? Somebody is living forever and ever and ever and ever and never die. But if back up a little back in the garden, God placed a tree of life and a tree of knowledge of good and evil, what I would call the tree of death. Man decided to eat from the tree of death, and death came up on the lineage of man in this mess that we are in right now. And so if he had eaten from the tree of knowledge of good and evil and eaten from the tree of life, then you have a conflict right there. One of the things that we have to understand is that God has a plan, and he is a very organized God, and he has a plan, and he knows exactly when everything will take place in its time. And so we see in our text now, after centuries and thousands of years after man sinned, in Galatians chapter 4, it says, verse 4, but when the fullness of time was come, God knew, in another translation, when the appropriate time was come, or when the time was full to accomplish his purpose, God sent his son. I read from the pen of inspiration, Ellen G. White, and she talked about the idea is that God waited for the human race to reach at an all-time low when sin was rampant around the world right now. The epidemic of sin had ravished the entire world. Jesus was born. Now, if Jesus was born in 2020, I think perhaps this world will be unsavable. Just think of it. But God looked at the whole schematics of time and he says, okay, well, you know, if he comes too early, you know, it's not going to be as effective. But if he comes exactly at that very time, you know, as Daniel prophesied in Daniel chapter 9, if he comes in at that time, AD 27, if he is come in at that time, just around the time, not AD 27, he was baptized AD 27, but back up just around the where we say year zero or year one, Jesus is inserted into humanity. That is the exact time in precision, as it says, the fullness of time, Jesus was inserted. The Emmanuel was inserted into the world. And God knew exactly when his son came, Jesus was injected into the world to be the vaccine of sin. Folks, we got to understand what this is, right? And some of you, I know we have a lot of medical people here, right? But he became the antidote. He became that one that would fight against sin. And if we accept the vaccine of Jesus Christ inserted in humanity, guess what? It will save us from eternal death and eternal ruin. If you don't believe me, read Revelation chapter 20. And so the Bible is very, very clear now that God knows exactly when he had to do what he had to do. In the book of Revelation chapter 1, verse 7, it tells us that I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And so if you want to understand how God works, wherever the beginning was, God was. And whenever the end will be, which will not be, if you understand, God is. God is the only self-existent human being, the only self-existent being in the entire universe. And when we say God, we're talking about God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. They're three distinct beings. The Trinity, as we call it, or as Colossians chapter 2 puts it, the Godhead. Very clear. And so God knew exactly when everything had to take place because everything had to work around for the salvation of a rebellious planet. Scientists, they are claiming that one day this world as we know it will be destroyed. Somehow this world is going to self-destruct, and sometime in the eons of the future, we're going to have a world that's going to self-destruct. Now, that perhaps will be true if man is left at his own to do whatever he wants to do on this earth. But we serve a God that's holding things in check. And we are told that there will be a time in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, there will be a time when the Lord himself shall come back to this earth. And he is coming back to this earth to save all of those individuals that accepted the vaccine. Now, I know somebody is going to come at me and say, Pastor, are you, you know, is there some subliminal message here? Are you like fighting against the anti-vaxxers? No, I'm not. I'm just simply preaching, right? But I just wanted to put that there. And so what we have to understand very clearly, only those that accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior will be saved. If you have not accepted Jesus Christ, you will not be saved. And it is very clear. And whenever we have a communion service, the communion service is actually a memorial of what you have already done or what you will do. It is almost to say that, Jesus, we recognize that you truly, you are the Lamb of God. You are the one that was sent from heaven to bring salvation to this world. You are the only one. I know that some of us like to be very eclectic in our theology, and we like to be, we like to involve others and embrace in other religions and say, well, yes, you know, Buddhism has its teachings, and that's true. Buddhism has its teachings, the Eightfold Path to Enlightenment, very good, nice. You could make some nice parallels with the Ten Commandments. Hinduism has its teachings as well. The three main gods of Shiva, Ganesh, and Krishna, as some would say that it mirrors the Trinity that we have in Christianity, and that's fine. Islam has its teachings too. Muhammad, he fought for his people, violently in some ways, but he was fighting for the right to maintain, civility and fighting under the direction of Allah, right? Yes, Islam has its teachings. Sikhism has its teaching. Taoism has its teachings. All of these religions have its teachings. But the only thing that they don't have that will bring salvation to the world is Jesus. I want you to understand what I'm saying. We are saying, from a Christian standpoint, there is no way that anyone can be saved other than Jesus Christ. It is Jesus and Jesus Christ alone. And I know that may be unpopular when we are speaking, as I'm a religion teacher and I started out in teaching world religions, and I had to be very inclusive in my teaching. Right, I couldn't stand up and say, well, Muhammad, as some people will say, is off the devil. I would never say that. Muhammad had some good teachings, right? And in Islam, they do believe in Isa, and they believe Isa, which is Jesus, and they believe that he is a good and noble prophet, right? But however, when the rubber meets the road, the only road to salvation, it is only through Jesus Christ. And I have to make it plain in Scripture, there is no other way that anyone could be saved other than what God has sent to the world, Jesus Christ. And so, folks, I want you to understand with me. I know that it is a very interesting thing to be, open to other teachings and other beliefs and all of that. And I encourage you, please get to know other teaching, get to know other beliefs, visit some of the mosques and the synagogues and get to understand who they are, what they are, where they started, and so forth. But understand fundamentally, from a theological standpoint, biblical theology, there is no other way that you can be saved other than Jesus Christ. And that is plain and simple. And so when we think of this whole thing, and I will give you an assignment. If you go into your New Testament, your King James Version, and just type in quotes, God sent, read all the accounts of God sent, and you'll find a very, very interesting thing to see when just that term, God sent, interesting. I read a little on this, and I'm just going to use this to make my bridge into my close, where in Genesis chapter 44, verse 7, it talks about Joseph. And Joseph recognizing what God is doing in his life and how God is able to work through the systems of man to prepare for the salvation of his people. In Genesis chapter 45, verse 7, it says, "And God sent before you to preserve you a posterity in the earth and to save your lives with a great deliverance. And he was talking about the whole idea that how God was able to send, orchestrate a way to send Joseph and permit Joseph to be sold in slavery, going down to Egypt. And then he was sold into Potiphar's house. And then from Potiphar's house, he was falsely accused of trying to rape Potiphar's wife. And then he was thrown into prison. And while he was in prison there, he interpreted two dreams. And then one of the dreamers died. And the other dreamer was appointed back to the house of Pharaoh. And then what was very interesting in the whole thing, this dreamer, that his dream that was interpreted, Pharaoh had a dream 2 years later, and he interpreted, he told of this one, this prisoner that interpreted his dream, and Pharaoh fetched him from the prison, and Joseph was able to interpret Pharaoh's dream, and the Lord worked it out, that he went from the prison and became the prime minister. Now, what I give you in a short synopsis, sometimes your life is going in a direction that you have no control. And you wonder, where am I in this foreign land? What am I doing here? God, I have done everything that I should do. I have been faithful in paying my, returning my tithe. I have been faithful to my wife and to my family and to my church and to my community. I have done all that you have told me to do. Why am I ending up in this mess? Could it be that God is sending you? Could it be that God is preparing a way to bring you into a new light for him to show for him to show you certain things that he has never shown you before, and to prepare you to bring a deliverance to a people? Amen. I remember when I was first called to Las Vegas. I grew up in Canada, educated back and forth in the eastern part of the United States, but primarily in Canada, never had an ambition of even working in the United States, much less Sin City, Las Vegas. And I got the call to come to Las Vegas. I said, oh, God, you're joking. That, you know, because God has a sense of humor, right? And I believe, you know, he says, yep, O'Neill, they want you over there in Las Vegas, right? And there's no way. And I consider my son, he was around 21 at the time, and my daughter, and she was about 9 years old. And I'm thinking, bringing my family into Sin City, that is irresponsible. And I'm pretty sure some of you guys, when you had your job offers or opportunities to come to Las Vegas, you scratch your head, you thought the same thing too. I said, there is no way. The Lord is blessing me where I am, and I truly believe that the Lord has some great things for me to do in New York City. I'm just in New York City, no, Montreal. And I'm trying to figure things out there. And I said, well, you know something? I don't know. But this just seems to be, there seems to be a deception in the whole thing. But sometimes that's what God does. He prepares you. You never think that you will be sent to Timbuktu to pastor or to be a missionary or to be a teacher or to be an engineer. But God opens up an avenue and you're able to, from my vantage point, look back now to where I was in 2012. And to see how the Lord has grown me in ministry to be more accepting of other cultures, even the culture of Las Vegas. And I'm talking everything in Las Vegas. The first time I came to church, and Brother Dennis, you were there, and I first came to church, and there was a section in church where, let me just say, a number of prostitutes, they would come and hang out there. And I'm like saying, what? And my question, I was saying, what are they doing here? You know, are they there to mess around with the church and all of that? But I come to realize that they need God too. They need God too. I've seen all kind of different individuals coming to church. I remember one time I was doing this crusade at Abundant Life, and a homeless man wheeled his way up to the front door with a shopping cart with all his belongings in it. And he got into the church with his dirty self, sat down, and he came for a few days listening to the word. And the few days turned into a few weeks. And the next thing I know, that this man stood up for baptism. Now, I could see the concern on some people's face, right? Needless to say, this man was, eventually, he was baptized. And it's interesting that he was set up to be baptized at the last. And I could understand why. When I baptized that fellow, went down the water, come out, the water was totally mud. And I thought to myself, and I pondered, and I was saying, yeah, you know, I'm a little, you know, some of you guys know I'm a germaphobe, right? And I'm like, But I thought to myself, I said, God, this is the true mission. This is the mission. We got to get down on our hands and our knees, amen? We got to sit with the homeless, right? We got to sit with those individuals that are hungry. We got to understand what true communion is all about. Jesus was sent to sit with sinners. Come on, guys. You see it from the Bible now, right? He was sent to mingle with sinners. He was sent to mingle with the rich. He was sent to mingle with everyone in all different areas in society, whether it be the children. They try to reject and say, no, Jesus is not, you should not even hang around with these children. You know, Matthew chapter 19, right? Jesus said, no, suffer it to be so, for such is the kingdom of heaven. And he rebuked the disciples, amen? Jesus was sitting with a Samaritan woman, right? And he was talking to a Samaritan woman, and they despised him. They were looking. He sat down and ate with sinners, and they were like, can you believe it? He is calling himself the Messiah or the great teacher, and he sits and eats with sinners? Because back then, they believed that if you sit and you eat with sinners, right, somehow the sin will be transferred onto you. Guilt by association. But Jesus, he was the great architect of righteousness. He wanted them to know that he was sent for a purpose. He was sent to bring deliverance to this world. Amen? He was sent to open the hearts of those that are brokenhearted. He was sent to open the eyes of the blind. He was sent to open the ears. He was sent to bring deliverance to those that are captive. He was sent to resurrect those that was dead. And we see all of that in the gospel. Jesus said this, the same thing as he was sent. He's saying, so I send you. And so the evaluation of your Christianity is really this. Do you find it difficult to do some of the things that Jesus Christ has commanded us to do? And we do, right? And this is where communion comes in. And I love communion time, because communion is not about us dressing up in white, in our nice black and white, right? Making sure your feet is washed from the night before, because you don't want to be shamed when you're washing your feet. Communion is not about that. Communion is not about coming dressed up and smelling good and all of that, and you taking all your emblems and taking on the body of Christ. Communion is a checkup for you to understand, if you cannot do some of the things that Jesus Christ is commanding you to do, Jesus says, hey, listen, you have no part with me. And so he gave the command to his disciples, just as he served in those 3.5 years of ministry. He wants us to serve as his disciples. We need to model what Jesus Christ did. And so the scripture is very clear in all of this. And so, folks, as we prepare ourselves for this communion service, it's very important for us to understand fundamentally what he wants to do in our lives. And if we just allow the Holy Spirit to have his way in our life, I tell you the truth, great things will come about, because you'll be able to see that your Christianity has meat on it. You know what I mean, meat on it? Many of us, we're just bone Christians, right? Now, you don't understand that. Somebody didn't get it, right? You're just bones, right? You know, it's just like, have you ever seen somebody who is starving and you just seen the bones, right? Some of us, that's what our Christianity is all about. Is we just do the minimum. We show up at church, we pay our tithe, so that they could say I'm good and regular standing, right? But we don't really get into the fellowship. We don't really get to one, know each other, partner with each other to go out. I've seen a few sisters and brothers from this church. They're all about service. And I won't call her name, but there was a sister I was so impressed a few months ago. We came together to do bread ministry here. And this sister was, you know, she put her bags together and she has food to help the homeless and so forth. And then she said, all right, let's go. And we walked over to one of these underground tunnels. We know about 6,000 homeless folks, they live under these underground tunnels. We call it the flood tunnels. Right? And there's a flood tunnel just right down here. Count about 30 steps from the front door of this church to the right. There's a flood tunnel there. And if you go there, you're going to see some people there. And they cross over and the tunnel connects to other over 300 miles of tunnels all across Vegas. And a lot of homeless folks live there. You drive on top of the freeway, you're driving over their homes. Last week when the flood came and flooded the tunnels, a lot of them got flooded out of their homes, right? And this sister walked, and she was so, curious to help individuals. And some people, they said, you know, we wanted to have flashlights and some of the supplies because it's dark under the tunnels. And I saw a sister from this church practicing true communion. When I'm talking about true communion, many of you are going to think you're going to leave here today and you're going to think that you have practiced true communion. We're not even scratching the surface. I'm talking about true communion where we go out to the homeless and help those that are less fortunate. Where we talk about, you know, somebody that is out of gas and you're able to drive the distance to go and fill that, help, even put whatever you can in their tank to get them going. I'm talking about communion. I'm talking about Christianity with skin on it, not with bones. Some of us, and I'm putting myself in the same category, we're just dry bones. Bones can't even move. But God wants truly for us to practice the real ideal and have the meat of his righteousness in us. And he's calling us into this calling, folks. Jesus, as the scripture tells us in John, is the bread of heaven. Is the bread of heaven. And so the bread of heaven, as John chapter 6 tells us, right, he is the bread that came down, like that manna that came down that fed the people. But that manna that came down that fed the people, right, we ought not to be selfish with the manna. We ought to share the manna. spiritually, physically, and mentally. As we have received, so we have received, so we freely give. As we celebrate the communion today, and as we eat of the bread, and as we drink of the wine, it is the encouragement of Scripture that we will not just have communion in church, that we will take communion to our homes, we will take communion to our communities, that we will take communion to our jobs, and that we will make a difference for Christ. If God can use 12 men to turn the entire world upside down, that thousands are added to it, can you imagine what he can do with us if we are anointed by the Holy Spirit? And if we leave here and we go in our area of influence, guess what? It will spread like wildfire. And this is what God is calling us into. The bread of heaven, Jesus Christ, the one truly that came that we will have life and have it more abundant. He's calling each and every one of us, folks. And as he's calling us, I truly believe that it behooves us all to respond. Fellow citizens of New Jerusalem, God is calling you into fellowship. Fellow citizens of that celestial city that will descend up on this earth, he's calling us into fellowship. He's calling us into communion. God has sent his son. And in John chapter 17, God is sending us. Will you accept this call to be sent under the anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit? Amen. If this is your desire, I'm going to ask you to stand with me. I believe God is calling us into this wonderful calling. A few months ago, this lady showed up at the Abundant Life Church. She has been studying on her own. And she said the Lord has impressed her that she needs to keep the Sabbath according to God's command. God sent her. This lady has shortly after that became very active in everything within the church. And one of the interesting thing is this coming Sabbath, the 13th, next week, is going to be a baptism. And she, and among others, will be baptized as well. Amen? And when I think of this, this is what God is sending us to do. To depopulate hell and to populate the kingdom of God. Amen? Now, there may be individuals at this time, and I want to make this an appeal. There may be individuals that want to stand forth and say, God, listen, I've had enough of this world. I want you to come into my life. I want to be a Christian with skin on it. I want to accept you, Lord. If there is anyone in our midst that want to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, to say, listen, I want to be baptized one day. I want to be prepared for baptism. Like that lady, Sister Rose, that will be baptized next week. I want to accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. If this is your design and desire and you want to accept him into your life, I'm going to ask you simply raise your hand. I want to say a special prayer with you. Praise God. I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to pray for God's anointing upon your life. Amen. Those listening online, all you have to say is baptized. And we will note that as well. But we want to pray for you. And we want to pray that your cup will be filled. Amen. And that truly the bread of heaven will feed you till you shall have no want. Father, I want to thank you, Lord, for your grace. Lord, as we stand here, we stand recognizing that we are citizens of the kingdom, that new Jerusalem that will come. I pray, Father, that you will bless each and every one of us. You have called each and every one of us, and you have sent us into this world to make a difference, Lord. And I pray, Father, that the anointing of the Holy Spirit that was upon the disciples in the apostolic church, that same anointing will be up on each and every one of us. We pray, Father, that we will have the purpose to fulfill the wishes of heaven and not our own, but your will. Lord, take full control of each and every family, each and every church, each and every individual listening in our midst, Lord. Help us to know, Father, that it's not about us, but it's all about you. Oh, Father, we pray for those that lifted their hands that will be prepared for baptism someday. I pray, Father, that you will so bless them, that you will seal their testimony and their covenant and their desire. And even those listening online, Father, may you seal them as well. Seal their commitment in you, Father. When all is said and done, Lord, we just want your name to be glorified and magnified. Thank you so much, Lord, for all that you have done and all that you continue to do. We pray in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Praise God. Please be seated. Fill my cup, Lord. This communion service, we want you to know that we practice open communion, as we said before, and so each and every person, you are welcome to participate at the table. Amen? And so as we prayerfully take these emblems, just remember that these are symbol of the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. We'll just invite the ladies to come forward and uncover the emblems. Thank you. At this time, we will have, you may be seated. Thank you. At this time, we will have the reading and the prayer for the bread.
I will be reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 and 24. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be here. Thank you for allowing us to take part and remember you and your life while you was on earth. We come in front of you at this time with our lives in disarray, and we are not perfect, but we remember the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. As we come to you today, we remember your death and your resurrection. This bread that we are about to partake in, let it cleanse us and change our lives, and let our heart be transformed so that we may live for you and choose you in everything that we do. We are not perfect, but with the perfect blood of Jesus, you can cleanse us and keep us pure. Be with us today as we participate, all of us, and those who are watching online and participating on Zoom. Continue to be with them as you are with us, and help us to live a life of transformation and a life of victory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Do we have anyone in our midst that would like to stand and give a brief one-minute testimony? Something that God has done for you that you want to just echo to just edify the church, strengthen the church. Testimony time, anyone? Amen. At this time, we invite the deacons to come forward. If you do have a testimony, just show your by your uplifted hand, and we will be happy to come to you. Where? Oh, yes, sister. Go ahead, sister.
My testimony is moving here to Las Vegas.
Okay, he has it.
Gracious enough to find the church and fill them in Sunset. And one of the sisters, which I was going to ask for prayer request, is Catherine. Sister Catherine was the one that welcomed me here to Vegas. After COVID, we, you know, was home and so forth. Not too long ago, last week, I reached out to her to see how she was doing. So she's doing well, and she's going to be having her x-rays done so she could come back to church, because I told her I missed her since I started coming back. Amen. Here. Amen. So that's my testimony, that God put me here in fellowship with you guys here in Vegas, because I have my family in Malibu.
Praise the Lord. Amen. And we welcome you, sister. And what's your name, please?
Elvira.
Sister Elvira. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you. All right. Deacons, just receive them. Just take. Amen. All right, please be seated. Is everyone served? Everyone served? All right. This represents the body of Jesus Christ. Let us eat this in a prayerful manner. Amen. Amen. Now, it is customary that if you had good food, right, and you had good bread, what do you say? Amen, right? Now, in some cultures, right, you have to burp by showing the indication that the food was good, right? Now, I won't ask you to burp, right? But I have to say the bread was good. Whoever made it, it was right on. Amen. And we want to thank you very much for a job well done. The food was good. Praise God.
Amen.
Amen. Come on, folks. We're not going to have that stoic communion, right? Praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
You enjoyed the food, right?
Amen.
Amen. And those online, some of you will be, you have been served. And we thank you very much for participating. I know Brother Theus and Sister Theus, we're going to come to see you in the hospital shortly after this. And we praise God for this. So in the same manner, the custom is that after you eat, then you drink. And so we will have the reading and the prayer for the wine.
Let's read.
I'm going to read 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 25 to 27. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drink this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord." Let's have a word of prayer. Lord Heavenly Father, thank you once again, dear Lord, for shedding of your blood. Thank you for coming down here, dear Lord, at the right appropriate time. For saving us from our sinfulness, dear Lord, and taking up the cross that we deserved.
Amen.
You shed your blood for us, dear Lord, that way we may be able to be saved and holy, dear God. Thank you once again for everything that you have done, for all your sacrifice just for us sinful beings, dear Lord, showing us what true love and communion and humbleness is all about. I pray that we continue to put our lives into your hands, dear Lord, that you will lead us and guide us in every step of our way, that we can be a true instrument, that we can give our own lives so that others may live, dear God. I pray that you help us to point them towards you. You cleanse us from all our unrighteousness. In Jesus I pray, in your loving name, amen.
Amen, amen. Praise God, praise God. Join us, please. As you are receiving the wine, which represents the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses us from all our sins, if there's anyone else that would like to testify of God's goodness, someone may have been diagnosed or you have had COVID and somehow it just brushed you. That's something to praise God for, right? I got it, and it lasts for 5 days, and I didn't even know I had it. I praise God for that, that the Lord kept me. Does anyone want to give a brief testimony? Something God did for you. Okay, sister. Just keep your hand up. Yeah, there you go. All right.
I guess I'm moved by the Holy Spirit to share my story. I know majority of you don't know about my life story, although some of my church family in Las Vegas people know about this, but not the whole story. So I'll make it very short. I really want to share, but I know if I'm going to, I'm going to break out because I can't believe that God has sustained my life until this time. March of 2020, just when the pandemic started here in the U.S., I flew over to the Philippines by myself. My family is here. And then I got there March 13. March 15, when the president, declared that the country has been going to lock down. So I flew over to our province. March 15, I couldn't fly back after that. So it took few more months. And then there was an international flight at that time, but there's no domestic flight. So I was just enjoying, I know, malls, there's no resorts, everything were closed. So I was enjoying myself, like going hiking and then swimming and just like walking, jogging. So one time we went swimming with my friends, my family, and my cousin. After swimming, so I felt that I really terrible, like my head's going to blow. So they rushed me to the hospital. It took an MRI, CT scan, and so doctor found out that I got brain hemorrhage, really heavy bleeding. There was no transportation going, since there's no neurosurgeon at that time from our place. And there was no transportation going to the other city to have surgery. But it took us like after 7 days before I got transported over to the other. Thank God, used some person to help me get into transported to other cities. So the neurosurgeon, when I got into the hospital, the neurosurgeon told me that by surviving for 7 days with heavy bleeding is already a miracle from God. That's what the doctor told me. So yeah, I had a surgery that was during the Sabbath. My sister told me. That was the time during the divine service when I had my surgery. So I know my church praying for me. A lot churches all over the Philippines, the pastors, they were fasting and praying, and they were earnestly praying for my operation that day. So yeah, and I thank God that was a ruptured aneurysm. And then I thank God that was supposed to be an 18th day trip. And it took me like more than 5 months before I flew back here to the U.S. And yeah, so this is to prove that we are serving a true living and a God that miraculously heals. So to all who are hoping, like feeling helpless right now, who are undergoing the same situation, like, you know, what I've been through. Yeah, we have a God of impossible that can do everything that, yeah, anyone can think is possible.
Deacons. Praise God, sister. Thank you. Power. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Is everyone served? All right. As you drink this, recognizing this is represents the blood of Jesus Christ that washes all our sins. Amen? Amen. Let us sing. Amen. Praise God. And so as the tradition states that right after Jesus fed the disciples and they ate in this way, it says they sung a song and departed. Amen? And so, folks, as we are about to sing our closing song, and as we are about to close this communion service, let not stop communion in this church. Now, let us go forth in our communities. Amen? Amen. As we do our community service, the bread ministries and other community services that you do, helping others in the community, remember that this is all a part of the communion that God has called us in to do, right? To have fellowship with our brothers and our sisters. What would be a wonderful thing if 3 months from now we come back, or even next week we come back and say, wow, look what the Lord has done. Amen? God has used me to bring others to Christ and to show forth his love. And so I want to encourage each and every one of us as we go forth, as we sing, and as we close, and as we go forth, that we recognize what God has done, what he has already done in our lives, and what he will do. Praise God. Let us pray together. Father God, we want to give you thanks. We want to give you praise, Lord, for all that you have done. You are great and wonderful God. We thank you, Lord, for this church family. We have communed together. We have fellowshiped together. We have laughed together. We have mingled together. And now, Lord, you have called us, Lord, not just to keep what we have in here, but for us to go outside and win souls for Christ. Lord, you have sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to make a difference in this world. And now you are sending us to make a difference in Las Vegas and in the surrounding regions. Continue to bless us. Provide for us, Lord. Be with those listening online. I pray that you bring healing and restoration to them as well, and that they will do accordingly in going out and making a difference for you. We thank you, Lord, and we praise you, for we ask these things in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and soon coming King. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And so, folks, as we invite our deaconesses to come forward and close our table, we know that this is going to be on to in preparation for next year, next month. It is the tradition for the deacon, for the people, when they finish the communion service, they said, next year, New Jerusalem. Amen? Amen? This is what we are looking forward to. We're looking forward to that city that will come down from God, that will descend from God, and we will be able to welcome Jesus Christ, amen, coming down to this earth. And as he will take us up to that wonderful city, New Jerusalem, where we will be for those 1,000 years before we finally come down to this earth. Amen? And so we pray that God will bless each and every one of us. And let us go forth practicing communion within our homes, within our community, and within our spheres of influence. May God bless you. And make you a blessing. Yes. Yeah.
Let us stand for our closing hymn. We'll do verses 1 and 2. The church has one foundation, is Jesus Christ alone. She is His new creation by water and the word. From heaven He came and sought her to be His holy bride. With His own blood He bought her, and for her life He died. Elect from every nation, yet one o'er all the earth.
And again, Lord, we thank You. We pray that as we leave this place, help us to know that we're not leaving Your presence. Continue to guide us, Lord, and provide for us. We look forward to our meeting that we will have within the week, our Bible class this evening, and all the other studies that we will have in the week. But ultimately, when we shall come together next Sabbath again, we ask that You bless us, Lord, and guide us, and help us, Lord, to be influencers within our spheres of influence, within our community and our family and our church and beyond. We thank You, Lord, for all that You have done. Bless us now, we pray, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen.